Hola, y'all. It's Thursday, and honestly, I have been in bed a lot of the day since I got home from work. After yesterday, I don't know, I still haven't recovered. I came home and took like a, I don't know, 20 minute, I just fell asleep for 20 minutes before I had to go get my kids from school. So I came straight home from my job, fell asleep, took a 20 minute power nap and picked them up, went and got a snack for them and came back and went straight to my bed and laid down in my bed. And now it's after 7. And when I get done doing what I need to do, I'm gonna go take a bath and I'm gonna go straight back to bed. Every time I come out here, I try to talk about something I've read, something I feel led to talk about, anything I'm dealing with or whatever. I try to stay real and authentic and not reach for what might sound good or seem good. And maybe every walk doesn't resonate with you. That's okay, because we're not the same person. But hopefully it resonates with someone. At some point, maybe it hits you where you're at, because we won't be at the same place at the same time. So, but I was pondering today I don't like the feeling of being stuck. I don't like that feeling in anything. It's like as soon as you start feeling stuck, then the joy is out of it. And it can be anything. So, I mean, if I feel, I'm going to give multiple examples here. If I feel stuck in my style, like, oh, I've only worn, I'm just going to give a ton of examples here. Oh, I've only worn this, whatever. I've only worn black belts with black shoes my whole life. That's what I've worn, black belts and black shoes. And now I feel hemmed in by that. Like, I can't do anything different than that because that's what I'm known for, matching. I'm the girl who matches her black belts and black shoes. And it was good for a while. I liked it. Maybe it was in fashion, maybe it was in style and trendy. Maybe I just liked it because I went through a phase where I like things to match. But that, it passed. Styles might have changed, trends may have changed, but even if they didn't, maybe I changed. And I don't want to wear my black shoes with my black belt anymore. Maybe I want to wear a leopard belt with purple shoes. People at work would say, Jesse would totally do that. So this example is kind of funny. And I'm going to bring up several examples to make a point. You know, feeling stuck is feeling hemmed in by something. It can be something of our own doing. It can be a box that somebody else put us in. It can be that we feel like we have to live up to a certain expectation. And so we assign ourselves certain attributes or whatever. But sometimes we change. Not sometimes. I think we're always in a state of changing. And those things that we once loved or embraced or felt truly that they identified us, we may not have the same feelings about them anymore. And that can change for various reasons. Maybe with my belt and shoes, I saw someone else where I just thought you always had to match your belt and your shoes. And I saw someone else wear belt and shoes that did not match, and it looked great. And it changed everything I'd ever thought about shoes and belts. This is such a wild example, I know. And I'm really known to my students, but also to my children, because my kids hate it, for giving outlandish examples to prove my point. Sometimes I give outlandish examples because you can really, to me, make a point with an exaggerated example. And I've just always done it, okay? Because sometimes kids and teens don't pick up on subtle examples. Some do, of course, but not everybody, okay? So if you make a really exaggerated example, everybody seems to get the point, because the example was never the point. That was just the vehicle to get your point across. So the belts and shoes are just an example, okay? All right, think of a house design, okay? I've heard I'm not good at decorating, and I don't know a lot about it. I mean, I decorate my house, but like, I'm not great at it. I don't know patterns and themes and colors of the year and whatever, and that's great. There are people out there who do, and that's more power to them. It's just not my thing. But I've heard of farmhouse before, and I know that farmhouse stuff has the words on everything. So like, if you're going to put your flower in a container, it'll say flower on it. And I love it. I love words. So yeah, I'm great with it. And I know it was in for a while. So let's just say that you did farmhouse and you invested thousands of dollars into making your kitchen farmhouse. I think that's what it's called. Maybe all the decorators watching this will be like, oh no, she got it totally wrong. It's called modern blah, blah, blah. I don't know. So let's just say you invested all that money. And then a farmhouse, from what I understand, is not just in the kitchen. It goes throughout. So it's like a simplistic, I don't know. I don't know enough to talk about it. But anyway, let's say you go with that theme and you like it and you love it for years. And then one day you walk into your kitchen and all you can see are all of these words staring back at you. Flour, sugar, butter, pantry, kitchen, fork, spoon. I mean, everything is labeled and it's all white or black. And you're like, you feel like you're suffocating because it's just too much. Like, you've stared at it enough. You've seen it. You've done it. You've experienced the farmhouse and you were in love with it for a while. But then you want to change it because it's not doing anything for you anymore. You want something different. It served its purpose, but you changed. The farmhouse didn't change. You changed, because it was always flour and sugar on a canister. But you changed, you evolved, you grew, and you decided, I don't like that anymore. I am really bad about always talking about relationships. And I could throw one in here as an example. And I was thinking the other day, I reach for everything under the sun when I'm trying to make a point. And I've lived long enough. I'm not old, I'm 37, but I've lived long enough to have experienced the things I talk about, I've experienced. But I just like to point out that I'm not, on some of these examples, I am not throwing out these examples because I guess what I'm trying to say is I'm not trying to throw my family or my friends under the bus. I'm not talking about people. Some of these examples are just that. They're just examples. I have experienced them in some form or fashion, but I didn't say in this lifetime. I didn't say it was when I was an adult. It could have been when I was a kid, or I could have watched it play out between someone really close to me or whatever. So anyway, the same thing can happen with a friendship and a relationship, you know, not a marriage. We don't want it to happen in a marriage. You know, anyway, that's not this walk is not about that. But you know, you can have a friendship or even an acquaintanceship, if that's even a word, someone that you're acquaintances with and you say hello and, you know, you don't really do a whole lot with them, but you know them, you know of them, and you've said hello and you're very cordial and whatever. people can have places in your lives, in your life, for different seasons. And then for whatever reason, there's like a rotation. No, it doesn't happen that way for everybody. And no, it doesn't happen with all your friends. Maybe there's a core group that just stay and then everybody else rotates. I don't know. But sometimes the core, you know, rotates. It just depends on your life and your seasons. And ow. Oh, I hit my thumb. Sorry. And what you're going through. But nobody wants to feel stuck. Getting back to the point. Because as soon as you feel stuck, your joy is snatched away from you. And the freedom of choice, you know, as soon as we lose our idea that I chose this, as soon as you lose that feeling of freedom that comes with, I'm doing this because I love it. I'm with them because I want to be. I'm here because I want to be. Whenever that feeling goes away and we feel stuck, we don't feel so great anymore. And there's a reason for that. You know, because I'm talking to the Lord today about that feeling of stuckness. And the reason why I think it's so dangerous to make decisions based upon stuckness is, usually, if you're stuck in a place, if you're stuck in a relationship, if you're stuck in a position, if you're stuck in a job, if you're stuck in a house, a decor, a style, if you're stuck, it's because you're too afraid to change. And I just don't think good decisions come out of a place of, I'm too afraid to move. That just seems, I don't want to say cowardly because I don't want to hurt anyone's feelings. It's very human. I mean, it's normal of us humans to feel that way. Okay, I got it. Thank you, Lord. He always seems to give me great examples. Okay. I thank you, God. He had to have brought it to my mind. All right, when my daughter was, she is, in February she'll be 11. When she was 6 months old, I'm going to make this story really quick. When she was about 6 months old, we were at church. One of my good friends, Angie, said, "What's that bruise on her face?" And I was like, "Oh, I've noticed a bruise." And I mean, I'm kind of la la la, but I mean, like, I feel like I would have noticed a bruise on her cheek. And I had not. And then I saw it and I was like, well, I don't know, maybe she bumped herself. Well, within a week, it just started growing like exponentially big. It was not long. I don't know, maybe 2 weeks. And it was massive. Long story short, went to the doctor, was scared to death, thought we had a tumor, thought it could be cancer. It was just frightening. They referred us to, they said, well, it's a blueberry hemangioma. Blood vessels get all knotted up underneath the skin. It happens about this time and it just continues to grow. And I have photos and it was just massive. Like, she couldn't lay her head on that side. Her cheek was just like, I don't know, 4 or 5 times the size it should be. And it was a dark blue. And they told us, we went to Children's Hospital in Arkansas, and I was just beside myself because, you know, that's where we found out it wasn't cancer or anything. And, you know, that was a relief. But then he said, we have a medicine called propranolol, and this is a heart medication. So we're going to run blood work, make sure she's fine. And we found this heart medication on accident. We use it in the NICU. Or in the hospital, I think he said NICU, for newborn babies who have heart conditions. And we noticed, just by happenstance, that some of these babies in the NICU had hemangiomas. And when we would give them this heart medication for their heart, someone observed that the hemangiomas would dissolve and just go away. So he said it was really miraculous, you know, because we were given this medication for one thing, and it solved two things. And I was so excited. I said, okay, great. He said, but if it doesn't work, the only other option is to cut open her cheek and to remove it, and then to close her cheek and pinch her skin together. And I was devastated by that. Not because I'm a shallow person, but because this is my baby, like 6 months old. The thought of her face being marred for the rest of her life was so upsetting because, you know what I mean? It's like, I'm the mom and I thought, do it to me. I can take it. I have my husband. He loves me. If my face is disfigured on one side, I have children and friends and I've done all this. I can handle it. But my precious, sweet, innocent, beautiful 6-month-old baby, it just doesn't seem fair to rip open her face, remove this hemangioma, and pinch together her face. And I had seen, and for the kids who had to have it done, I understand it's what you have to have done. And I am by all means not saying anything ugly or negative, and we would have done it if the medicine had not worked. Thank God it did. I'm getting to the point. But I had seen photos of children who had to have it cut out surgically, and they're beautiful children. But, you know, their face was, you know, there was scarring, a significant amount of scarring, depending on the size of the hemangioma. And having to cut all that out and then pinch the skin together, you can imagine what that would look like. So we started giving her the medicine. Within a few days of doses of medicine, the hemangioma softened because it was real hard. It softened and just started going away. Okay. So we kept her on it for a while because the growing season was months. So we had to keep her on that medicine while it was growing. And then he said, you know, after the growing season is done, the medicine will dissolve it completely and she will never have it again. So I was like, wow, we were praising God that it worked. The medicine worked. We went on vacation. Now it's a heart medication, so keep that in mind. We went on vacation and I left the propranolol at home. Okay. And I was like, oh my goodness, I don't have her propranolol. And we were gone for a week. Well, you're not supposed to stop medication cold turkey and then start it back up cold turkey. Well, when we got back, I was worried about giving her the propranolol because I just stopped it abruptly. And I was afraid of what it could do to her heart. So I wouldn't give it to her. And I waited for another appointment with the specialist at the Children's Hospital. Not St. Jude's, Arkansas Children's Hospital. So when we went back in there, I couldn't get in for like another month. You know, it's hard to get into those places. And I waited for our next follow-up appointment. So we go in and of course her cheek looks great, but it had not finished shrinking completely because I had not been giving her the medicine after that week. And I went in and he checked it and he went to ask me a question. And I broke down in the chair. I still remember it very well. And I just started sobbing. And I told him what I did. And I felt horrible. I felt like the worst mom on the planet. But I was so scared I was going to give her a heart attack or something, you know, by giving her that medicine after a week off. And I just started crying and crying and crying. And I said, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I messed up. I'm so sorry. And I told him what happened. And he was sitting on that little chair, you know, that has wheels on it. And he wheeled up to me and he said, it's okay. You're fine. He said, you did exactly right. And I said, you know, I was like wiping my face. And I was like, what? He said, we're doctors. And that's what doctors do. And that's what medicine is. It's a practice. He said, and we're used to weaning people off of medications. Because we've deemed that the safest way to do it, to wean them off and not to stop cold turkey. He said, but, oh, I'm trying to think of how he worded it. He said, what you did was what we are all afraid to do, which is just stop at cold turkey. And he was insinuating that a lot of the times, medicines and things like that, when they've served their purpose, now I know there are side effects. Don't come at me in the medical field, people. I'm just telling you what this doctor said to make a sobbing mother feel better. He said, you did what's right. He said, we're all too scared to stop a medicine abruptly. He said, but you did it and she's just fine. You're okay, mom, you're okay. You did great. You know, he was comforting me, I know, but I held on to what he said. Like, you did what we all want to do, but we're too afraid to do because we're taught to wean people off medicine due to a possibility of adverse side effects. So people stay on medicine longer than they really have to. You know, medicine has its own side effects. And I've always held on to that because number one, he made me feel a lot better. And he was very, his bedside manner was amazing. And then he admitted, a doctor to a patient, imagine this, a mother. He admitted that mother's tuition, because it was the mother in me that said, I'm not giving her propranolol, a heart medication, after accidentally stopping it abruptly. I'm not going to put it back in her system abruptly. I'm not going to take that chance on my baby. And he was like, you did what we were too scared to do. And maybe it doesn't fit in this story and what I want to talk about today, but I think it does. I don't want to make decisions based upon a place of fear from the feeling of stuckness. And I've already went way longer than I wanted to, so I'm going to wrap it up. But so often in our lives, we just want to be comfortable. But you know, I teach kids. I am a teacher. I have children and I teach students. And there's not anything in me, I don't believe, that would tell my students, you can ask them. There's nothing in me that would tell my students, be safe, settle for less, take the easy road. Don't go for your dreams if they're too high and lofty. You just need to stay down here and get a normal job, or stay here and stay in a okay relationship, or, you know, don't be too adventurous. I mean, don't travel overseas. You just need to be safe and be comfortable. And no, I don't live my life that way. And I am certainly not gonna tell or teach somebody else. Or if they ask my advice, I'm not going to tell them to live their life that way. Nobody wants to live a life where they feel like they're stuck. And that's what happens when you are not in love with what you do or where you're at. And if you don't find meaning and purpose, especially if the only reason you're where you are at is because there's some underlying current that is holding you. It's like the mud that your feet are stuck in. Like your spirit wants to soar. I want to go do this. I want to be here. I want to accomplish this. And my heart is this, but my feet are stuck in the cement of this because it's all I've ever known, or because I invested so much money and time in it, because you can insert whatever. And you might say, well, what does this have to do with God? Well, I'm talking to God today about the feeling of being stuck. We serve an amazing God. I mean, He made everything. He breathed it, made it, created it, fashioned it, named it. He did it all. He's not boring. He's not bland. I don't think God wants you to have a boring, uninteresting, comfortable, non-exciting, stuck life. I don't. I mean, He took the children of Israel through a Red Sea. That's pretty exciting and not comfortable at all. They were in slavery, but comfortable in Egypt. But God said, nope, it's time for you to go. It's time for you to move. We got a better place to be. Even when they don't want to, because they got out in the wilderness, they're like, at least we had onions in Egypt. They'd already forgotten that brick quota daily because of their onions and lentils or whatever. But God was like, no, we're not going to stay there. We've done it. We've done that. And we're going to move on. I studied when I was teaching my adult Sunday school class about Paul and the missionary journeys that man took. He was going everywhere. He would literally go into a town, and I was telling my class, it was crazy because it's like history would just keep repeating itself. He'd walk into a city, preach them the truth, have some converts. The religious leaders of the city would get angry, try to stone him, kill him, kick him out. He would pick up his stuff, and he'd go to the next town, and he'd do it all over again. That is definitely not a feeling of stuckness. doing what God called you to do and not caring what anybody else had to say or think about it. And if they didn't accept it, that was on them, but you did what you could. And then you moved on to another place, and you did what you could, and you moved on to another place. This is way too long. Majority of you guys will check out long before you get to this part. But I just want to tell you today that if you are battling with a feeling of being stuck in your life, I want to tell you a couple of things. Number one, talk to God about it. Pray about it. Sometimes He gives us that feeling of stuckness that we're like, oh, I have to get out of this. I don't feel good in this. This is not what's for me anymore. He makes us feel uncomfortable with our place and position because He's getting ready to move us. He sends things our way. He preps us in advance sometimes. You know, He says, I will do a new thing. Can you not see it? Can you not perceive it? I'm going to bring streams into the desert. God is a God of doing new things, exciting things. And living for God is that. It's exciting, and it's not, I don't feel stuck with God. And if you do, talk to Him about it. Maybe He's prepping you for a change. Maybe your season in that. Maybe your season with them. Maybe your season in Louisiana or wherever you live. I don't know. It's coming to an end. Maybe He's moving you to a different place. Maybe He's moving you to a different job. Maybe He's moving you to a different city, a different group of people. Maybe you're moving into a different ministry. Whatever that is, accept it. And good gracious, do not stand in the concrete of stuckness because you don't want to sell your house or lose your benefits at your job, or you know, you're gonna miss your friends. But friends are friends forever. I have a friend that moved to Texas. We still talk. You know, good friends, they last even if you move. But let's just make sure that in our feelings this way, that we talk it out with God and we find out what His will is. But, you know, and I guarantee you, I don't even bat an eye at it. If you talk to God, He will answer you. If you ask Him, what do I need to do? Where do I need to go? Why do I feel this way? He will help you. And if you're supposed to be somewhere else by His design, then you need to go. Like, He should tell you to go. He's going to tell you to go, and you need to listen and go. Because life down here is too short. We're going to have eternity with Him, but we only get one shot down here. And I don't know about you, but I have a bucket list like 2 miles long. I really do. I am that person. I have a bucket list. I want to check things off before I die. And there's a ton of them I haven't done yet. But I'm going to. I'm going to. I don't want to feel stuck. There's no freedom in that feeling of being stuck. And it's not a way to live. Not for me. The only thing I'm going to be stuck to or with is God. And of course my husband and my kids. But you know, we're not talking about that. Happy Thursday.